invited here to shake things up and make sure that we get some people angry about what I have to say. Thank you for inviting me. I so appreciate it. It is in fact true that I have been involved with historic house museums and small historic sites in the United States for over 2 decades. And I just recently left the Historic House Trust of New York City, which we had 23 house museums that I managed, to really expand on a cultural consulting firm, Twisted Preservation, and it's growing out of the book itself. I just want to say that she got the books, not me, so I'm not trying to peddle the books. And if you buy one, I think I make 3 cents, so thank you so much. So I'm going to jump right in because, in fact, I've got a lot to talk about in very short amount of time. The first thing that I would really like to say, and I tell everyone this, is don't believe anything I say, that people have called me a menace, that people have gotten up and left during my lectures. I've had people call me an idiot. I wrote a blog post about it. Just in an audience like this, a woman raised her hand and called me an idiot. So I'm used to it, and the reason why this image is up here is because I most recently, before the book was even published, I was labeled the seven-headed dragon of the apocalypse to history. So with all of that, I will now just dive right in and tell you what I think about history and preservation. I think if there's one thing that you get out of what I have to say today, it's really this quote, and that is that we're in a time between times and a place which is no place. Now that sounds scary, but it also is full of potential. I think if we come to this event today thinking that we understand what preservation is, that we understand what heritage is, then we understand what kind of cultural authenticity is, my suggestion is that things have changed and that we no longer have such clear definitions as we did even probably 20 years ago, 10 years ago. Things are changing so quickly. There are 3 videos on this slide, and I'd like for you to just watch them and understand that these have just occurred in my lifetime. And so these changes are really kind of tectonic in social change. Now these are all based on the United States examples, but of course you can in your own head make those connections to Canadian examples.
I think we must consider who Thomas Jefferson was. The idea that Thomas Jefferson could have had a young mulatto mistress in a house overflowing with young children whom he adored is inconsistent with everything we know about William Thomas Jefferson. His granddaughter Ellen said, "There are such things as moral impossibilities."
Can you hear okay in the back?
I didn't know they were all against
it. We could go away, but it's the principle, it's the law. I don't think it's right.
Lay census to 1 year and state penitentiary.
What are the things that can only be done together by man and wife that they can't do in Virginia?
We'd pinch ourselves and say we're handling a major civil rights case.
I'm not going to divorce.
These were two women that had been together 42 years. Normally a wedding is the beginning of something, but this was a culmination of a lifetime together. I had been asked if I would go to the airport and conduct the wedding ceremony there because Thea was in the final stages of MS and had been given 6 months to live, and her dying wish was to get married in Toronto. No one could have predicted that Edie, following Fia's death, would be courageous enough to take on the entire same-sex marriage battle on her 83-year-old shoulders and face the Goliath of the Supreme Court and win.
And so just in these three videos, and I could have filled this with many more, of course, you can see how interpretations of historic sites, if they wanted to, could take in a great deal of social kind of changes that have occurred. In my experience, most historic sites don't address any of these issues. And in fact, 1 year after this Ken Burns documentary on Thomas Jefferson, of course, we know that the DNA testing was done and that Sally Hemings and Thomas Jefferson, in fact, had a significant intimate relationship with children. And so this is another issue about historic sites, which is that we like to say conjecture, gossip, and rumor are something that we don't like to embrace, when in fact conjecture, gossip, and rumor could in fact be next year's historic fact. Historic sites haven't really grasped that very well.
New York City. There are many museums to visit here, but so far, none like this. Turning the abandoned storefront of an historic reclaimed building into Morris, the Museum of Reclaimed Urban Space.
There's an alternative history of New York City which needs to be recognized. It's a history built by regular people who contributed to their neighborhoods, built community gardens, rebuilt their neighborhoods with sweat equity and their own passion. And this is a history we need to recognize and build.
I'm here to ask for your support to design and build a portable historical society that can navigate the bustling urban environment of today's Soho while showing a glimpse of its past. Using unconventional media such as a viewmaster and a smell station, I'll chronicle the evolution of Soho from rural farmland to high-end retail hub, charting its cycles of development and thus placing current-day Soho in the context of New York City's history. When I was growing up here, I remember walking down desolate streets. There were no stores or restaurants, but I felt safe because everyone who lived here knew each other. When people think of Soho today, they think of high-end shopping and expensive lofts. Nobody thinks of it as a tight-knit community where people actually knew and liked their neighbors. That was the Soho of my childhood, and that was the Soho out of which ideas such as the adaptive reuse of buildings and loft living were born, ideas that influence how we live today.
Now, these two examples are from New York City, but this is happening worldwide. That the museum field, kind of from the outside, on the margins, are moving away from the kind of top-down, honorific, single, usually white male, as person for whom the shrine has been preserved, to grassroots up, individual, talking about narratives that are about all of us spread apart rather than the single focus. So we're going from a kind of preservation mentality which is centralized to a preservation mentality which is decentralized. I'm showing you two examples here. Again, this is in New York City. This is a small elevator museum that has rotating curated exhibits of basically just stuff. And this is a gentleman, I think in San Francisco, who just turned his apartment into a house museum. You can go sit on his couch, put your feet up on the coffee table and watch TV with him, making the point, what really is historic? What is of value?
Open House is a unique event space. It is a collaboration with the people of York, Alabama, to transform a blighted property in York's downtown into a new public art project that has the shape of a house, but can physically transform into a 100-seat open-air theater free for the public.
So here you go. A historic house in York, Alabama is actually deconstructed and turned into something that's actually really useful for the community, which is a 100-seat theater. What I'm showing you on this page are all the things that are happening around preservation and around the museum profession that are kind of like circling the drain. So we've got this kind of notion about what to do with historic sites. We all know about the visual storage, like all the stuff that are in all those warehouses that museums never show? Well, these are the things that are really getting people interested in museums, actually seeing the collection, the mass, not the single curated thing that is really spectacular. They want to see the thousand things and make up their own mind about what's spectacular. I'm sure you're all aware this is happening in Boston. This is the President's House at Harvard. That students actually are now kind of in a guerrilla historian perspective, taking names of slaves and taping them up on the houses and on the monuments, saying this is not so-and-so's house, this is also the house of these three slaves. Interestingly enough, this house just put up a bronze plaque with this, just to show you how history is now kind of being forced into reflecting what's happening in culture. In the United States, of course, we've got the Black Lives Matter is really pushing towards the removal of Confederate statues, bronze plaques, street names that are related back to the Confederacy. We also know, as an example of how preservation and museum studies are moving away from the general to the specific, that guess what? History is no longer just about George Washington. History is about your DNA. Your very individual DNA now is historic. You can pay $200 and you can get that information. It's no longer something that has to be taught to you. That in fact, you can take it on yourself. Now this is a book that was just published, Charity and Sylvia. You know, the notion of same-sex marriage is not new since 2010 for Canada and, you know, just recently for the United States. This is a book about colonial America, two women who presented themselves as married. And there's documentation, and this story talks about that. This is most recently in the primary in New York State. People started taking their I voted stickers and taping them to Susan B. Anthony's tombstone. So all of these things are about kind of the grassroots ownership of what has to this point been given to them. History has been given to them. What's appropriate has been given. And so this slide kind of suggests a movement towards a grassroots understanding of culture and preservation.
Had thousands of photos, but I've been doing it for months and nobody was paying attention. One day, I started a page called Humans of New York. We started getting one new fan a day, two new fans a day. And I said, forget everything else. This is what's working for me. And so I just started uploading my pictures directly to Facebook, and then all of a sudden it just...
Do you remember the happiest moment of your life?
Page passed in puck and then I shot the board.
Where in the wrong were you from? See, I'm really plain looking everywhere.
It's like super plain.
That's a great call, like the real one. I'm really plain looking everywhere.
Thinking when we walk down the street and we see all these people and we do kind of wonder about their stories. The celebrations and the victories, and that's what people are engaging with.
What's your greatest challenge right now?
It doesn't matter. Just go day to day.
What's the hardest part about math?
Fractions.
Fractions?
Yes, I hate fractions.
I hate fractions too.
What I really hope to maintain is the culture of positivity, of celebration and support that these people share.
Now, this is a preservationist out of Columbia University. What you're seeing is his thesis, which is that the dust and debris of culture is worthy of preservation itself. And here he's taking latex on the inside of Trajan's column and then pulling off the dust and debris. And what you'll see is that this becomes a sculpture in itself. So the very notion of preservation is preservation of the stuff that we throw away. So if we take that kind of video of Facebook, the kind of humans of New York, the kind of individual granular person collectively becomes worthy of a kind of narrative. And that's precisely what's also happening in preservation itself. That it's not just the building, it's not just the Parliament, it's not just Bellevue, it's not just the single site that documents and stands for a kind of historic episode. It's all of the stuff that goes on behind the scenes. And just to show you that I tried it myself, this is September 1st from my vacuum cleaner, me cleaning my apartment for one day. That's all of the dust from my apartment. So it's no different than what this preservationist is doing here, that this stuff is meaningful. We seem to not have a problem when we think about an archaeologist going into a privy. We understand that that was waste, and now it's just this kind of amazing information that we can get historically. It's just getting more granular. Now, also, all you have to do is just look at popular culture. We're all fairly familiar with Architectural Digest, right? On the covers, you've got these rich, famous people, and you flip through the book, and they're beautifully curated, spectacular houses. I'm a designer. I like Architectural Digest. But now for a moment, let's also just pay attention to what's happening in the shelter magazines today. This magazine and Appartamento, and this is the image of one of the interiors that they're showing. So all you have to, I don't even need to say anything. You can see this kind of shift away from kind of highly curated spaces to how you live in your house. I'm interested in how you live. Well, this is something that started to inform the research that I did with historic sites. But all of these videos I'm showing you, and you seeing these two kind of lines, parallel lines of shelter magazines, should start to give you some sense of where the culture is shifting in terms of the environment, in terms of what's worthy of photographing, what's worthy of being put into a magazine. And this should start to inform our decision making. Now, on top of all of this, culturally, I think we all know about outsider artists. This is an outsider artist that my partner and I kind of sought out in Birmingham, Alabama, Joe Mittner. And just think to yourself, because this should be a historic site. This should be a historic house museum. Ask yourself how you would do that. Here's the interior to this house. How in the world would you do that? The complexity is starting to just kind of be mind-boggling when you start to think about, and Cool House talks about this, that preservation is becoming so immediate that if I pick up my glasses and put them down, that that's being seen as a historic act. So how are we supposed to deal with this kind of preservation?
A home will commemorate the lives and the stories that homes contain. Think of your home. Think of your house. The stories that are told. This memorial homegoing service will coincide with the building demolition as an opportunity to celebrate the lives of the homes that this home has touched.
House you grew up in, or a bedroom that was really important to you, there is an emotional tie to that place and to those four walls. And I feel that most people have cared at one point or another for those places that they've lived. Freedom for a Home is an opportunity as both an art project as well as a public history project to reflect on the meaning of our housing stock here in Philadelphia.
Try to think about it as if this is the last year of this home's life. And so this is an opportunity to commemorate the stories and the families that lived in that home and to give it a proper memorial service.
We are here to remember the past. We are here to reflect on the present. We are here to look for the future.
Pieces of public history that's actually taking place right now. And so the notion of this lone house acknowledging its narrative. I should be so lucky that a programming at a historic site would make people who attended cry. So there is something very deeply emotional about the potential of everything I'm showing you, whether or not we grab hold of it, whether or not we use it. Whether or not we take it as part of our museum practice is another thing. Now this slide is difficult for some people, but there is an entire movement right now which is about green burial. And the reason why this is important to me is because my most recent research is about the relationship of how we personally and intimately feel about our own mortality and death, and how we choose to express that in the way we preserve our environment, our buildings. So the way that we preserve something is a direct reflection on how you feel about your relationship to your own mortality. So there are fashion designers now that are designing fashions that will degrade, that it's no longer your best suit or your best dress that you're buried in, that you're actually wanting to become part of the earth. There are new technologies where you're actually buried in a sack, and this sack grows a tree, so you become part of nature. And there's fashion designers that are looking at the actual kind of content and preservation of the process of burial and death. And I find this kind of interesting when I think about how we care for our artifacts, how we care for our house museums, our historic sites. I don't answer that for this group, but I pose it back to think about how your relationship to your own mortality affects how you view preservation. I think it's a really kind of potent and, again, potential for preservation. Now, this one we all know about, but it is kind of interesting what's happened. The top is because of the ISIS destruction of the museums. This is a 3D printing process that is reproducing pieces that have been destroyed. And if you notice, in the middle of these 3D printing pieces are computer chips. So if these ever get damaged, that the computer chips can just rebuild the thing. It's an acknowledgement that perhaps things can live beyond the physicality of their being. And then this is recent, but this is a total reconstruction, fake, inauthentic, of King Tut's tomb. And I'm showing you the image of everything. You know, it's a computer-generated printed image, and then it's a foam cast on top. And then they put the whole thing together with the sarcophagus of the mummy. And this thing has even fooled at a distance archaeologists. Its level of degree of specificity for preservation. Now, I know that we have archaeologists here today, preservation architects. I'm only touching on these because I assume that they'll talk more about them, but this kind of technology is overwhelming preservation. The kinds of authenticity, the questions of preservation are just getting larger and larger. And so what all of this has done has really made me kind of question what is authentic and what do historic house museums have to do to become engaged in this larger kind of social conversation. And I always start back with kind of what the romantic notion of house museums is. And this is a child's book, 1942. The house, you know, is beautiful. The city grows up around it, it gets moved because the city's around it, and they put it back in a place that looks almost exactly like it was originally. So there's this kind of romance about preservation that has just permeated everything that we've done. Our goal is that last picture. We destroy and erase all of this. Now this is contrary to everything else that I've been showing you that society is kind of becoming aware of. So the notion of a pure preservation perspective, whether it's a house museum or a historic site, is changing. Now, whether or not we choose to kind of accept and understand that is a different issue. And then we know that there are several kind of categories of house museums. This is Bellevue, where the house kind of, you know, degrades, and then they come in, and then they fix it all up back to this particular period. The Gamble House, which is right here, where if we're lucky, all the furniture's there, so it's this kind of special spot. And then we have these kinds of house museum villages, where we pick them all up, and we move them, and people wear costumes, and you go there, and you pretend you're in ye old village. And then we have this kind of period room thing where we really don't want the building, but the room's pretty cool. So what we do is we dismantle the room, we move it into a museum, and then there's all levels of artifice about that, because not only is it removed from its original location, it's usually interpreted very much just like an artifact, like a ring or a piece of jewelry. And so with these different ideas of historic houses and period rooms, I started to really question what was authentic. And in the middle of all this, as many of you do, my daughter and I went to historic house museums on vacation. This one woman was telling us how important this lady was in this picture. The tour was really boring. She left the parlor room. We were supposed to follow her. My daughter turned around, made this face because the painting was anything but attractive. And the woman came back, shamed my daughter, yelled at me, made us walk up with her to the front and not touch any collections items. So I got in the car, and that's where Anarchist Guide came from. Here's someone who spent over 20 years working at historic sites, and I'm leaving pissed off and frustrated because I didn't feel welcomed, and I didn't feel like that was an authentic experience. And this was really the beginning of the research for Anarchist Guide. Now, whether you're any of those four kinds of historic sites, it doesn't really matter to me, because my frustration has brought me to the point that we're essentially cows looking at a painting of cows, looking back at cows. Don't try to tell me it's authentic. Don't tell me you're bringing it back to a period of interpretation. Don't tell me that the wallpaper is exactly what it used to be. And don't tell me you spent $60,000 on paint analysis to get the color for the room exactly right. Because ultimately, it's feeling like I'm a cow looking at a painting of cows, looking back at a cow. Now, what does this mean, right? I can say that, but what does this ultimately mean? Because I'm just as goobery as everybody in this room, right? You're spending your Saturday come and talk about preservation in house museums, right? So I'm one of you, right? So for me to express this kind of sacrilege, is kind of important. What does it mean? What can I do with this? Let's make this productive. Well, in the research, we came about with five primary critiques of house museums and historic sites. And we go into depth in these in the book, but each one of these are really important.
On the floors, and Jefferson was wandering around in his slippers serenely with tea, pretending that he was living in complete order. So here's a man who had a rage for order almost unprecedented in American history, and yet
Look, I love preserved sites and house museums, but they don't really reflect how people lived in them. Certainly not Monticello in the United States. And this is just one example of this critique, which is preservationists and conservationists and museum people have made these sites something that they never were. And people are not believing us. And by the way, it's costing too damn much to do that. So why do we have to keep asking for money to do something that we don't even want to see any longer? The second critique. These are two videos from 1958. The one that's playing right now is Jacques Tati. This woman in her plastic muumuu lives with her family in a modernist house, and she spends her entire life dusting everything to make it clean and perfect. So that's all she does through the whole movie. Do you ever feel like that? And then the opposite extreme, which is this Jack Kerouac black and white film.
Early morning in the universe. The light is getting up, poking up the windows. And it's lofted in the Bowery and Lower East Side, New York. She's a painter and her husband's a railroad brakeman. And he's coming home in a couple of hours, about 5 hours, from the local. Of course, the room's in a mess. There's her husband's coat on a chair. Been there for 3 days. Neckties and his tortured socks.
And so which one of these do you think house museums have gone in the direction? I mean, people complain that historic sites and house museums are way too curated, that they really don't feel comfortable, they don't feel there's an intimacy, they don't even feel like it was a real place to live. The next critique is that house museums are just boring. With all the stuff that we do, with all the money that we spend, with all the attention that we put towards interpretation and tours, people come and they're bored. And people like me will keep coming back because we love the places, but we wonder why people don't keep coming back. Because they're telling people, don't go to that place, it's boring. Between the ropes and the guided tours, you know, everything about the experience is boring. The top row are kind of experiences that you get at house museums, and the bottom row are things that are happening out in culture. Social media driven, interactive, grassroots, everything physical and immersive, not what you get at historic sites.
So everyone is recording this.
And then of course, you know, I've got my smartphone right here. I think probably most of you have smartphones. I'm tweeting right now and I Instagrammed a little bit earlier. Most people think that historic sites and house museums have nothing to say with present culture. They don't address anything on the front page. Communication is essentially a handwritten note on tape to the front door. That there's no attempt at making it relevant or useful to present day. That it's all about history and thinking back and portraying things the way they used to be. There's no attempt at kind of dovetailing it with what our experience is right now. At least in the United States, less than 3% of historic sites are designated for minority narratives. So this was at an Alice Austin House fundraiser. Alice lived in this house for 50 years with her life partner, Gertrude Tate. and it's called the Alice Austin House. And at this point, the Lesbian Avengers were raiding this fundraiser because they refused to acknowledge that she was lesbian or that she lived in the house for 50 years with her partner. So again, this is an example of culture forcing a kind of new interpretation. This was in 1986, and you can imagine that these same things are happening. Finally, though, this house has just walked the Pride Parade in New York City. That's after all of this time, not acknowledging her relationship. So, another critique, the final one, is that historic house museums are kind of social propaganda. They only tell a story that people want to be told. It's top down. Remember everything I showed you before? People are not interested in top down. So also, doing research, we say that, oh, attendance is low, but what does that really mean? These are two houses I did research in Philadelphia. 600,000 people walked in front of these houses. These percentages are how many people actually entered the house. 0.28%. And that's for weddings. That includes weddings. So to walk through for a tour. Now this is probably one of the most touristy spots in the United States. Now, one of our research tools was that we asked our researchers to do 1-minute videos of their personal habitation, their collections, house museum experiences, and then how their lives might overlap with historic lives. One thing we realized was text was not going to explain what was boring about house museums, right? So that's where these 1-minute videos started to come around. And we have many of these 1-minute videos which show us the museum experience with the roped off rooms, the barricades, the plexiglass, the hundreds of do not touch signs, the chairs with ropes on them, the fake fruit, the solid-looking wine in glasses, the on and on and on and on. All these things start to become noted in these videos versus how people really live, how their houses really look, how people envision their collections as being animate or alive. How would you do this if this were part of your house museum? How would you show this collection that this person saw it as animate? And then everyone has one of these anarchist tags on their seat. It's just an example of something that's really inexpensive to do. But if people do come to your site, this is great because it's not an exit survey. It's anonymous. And you just give them this and ask them to write whatever they want and drop it wherever they want. And you learn locational data. You get really good information. It's not like a sticky that you would put up on a frame, a kind of curated opinion piece. This is really finding out locationally where in the house people are interested in, what they're really feeling, a really fascinating kind of crowdsourcing of data. Another tool that we worked out was energy, imagination, and excitement. I understand it's quasi-scientific, but this research had never been done. So we just jumped right in and said, okay, let's just try this. So you guys make something better, and then call me up, and I'll start using that. The thing to realize is the stuff that was least interesting or lowest is all the stuff that we pay attention to. All of our restoration, all of our interpretation, all of our collections items, everything that's made to look pretty and special and highly curated is low, and everything that tops out the top, outside, because they can breathe, unrestored spaces, things like graffitis on walls, cracks in walls, things that we probably wouldn't want people to notice because it's not purely preserved, those are the things that get the highest ratings in this kind of documentation. We also do these workshops where everything is open. You can sit on the furniture. You can look through the books. We use anarchist tags. And this way, we start to get data about what people really are interested in doing. We also have tracked a regular tour, which in this house was a hallway with plexiglass on the door. We took the plexiglass down, did a workshop, we tracked people. Everybody also has on their seat a distinct activity sheet. If you want to fill that out, that's fantastic, because I'll include you. What we do is we end up with what these square footages are. It's a new way of interpreting house museums, that you have a distinct activity per square footage. And so what it does is it starts to take it away from, well, this is the standard guided tour. If I told you, you have to have 32 distinct activities in your total house museum or historic site, start about it from distinct activities. And that's explained a bit more in that sheet. I'm more than happy to talk further about that. Also, the notion of the community. Without a doubt, house museums and historic sites tend to pretty much ignore their communities. That's why I love hearing about your kind of goal for community programming. It's all about the community. It's all about making your site relevant to people's lives. It's really that simple, but this is a pilot project where we produced this mobile kiosk unit, and we drove around in Flushing, Queens to bus stops, talking to people about what brightens your day. And we tied that back to a historic site. And so ultimately, in the book, we end up with this kind of matrix that the more black you have, the more experimental you are, the more anarchist. And the important thing here is that ultimately it kind of ends up being color-coded. And this is for you to do yourself, not for somebody to judge you. But most historic sites think, oh, well, we have really good tours. But they don't really think about everything else. So if you recall those five critiques, each one of those critiques is its separate section. So this matrix forces you into thinking about your site from a comprehensive view, which has to do with the community, communication, the experience, the environment, and then the building itself and the shelter. And all those things are kind of gone into in detail. But the important part here is that these sites cannot be seen in isolation. Not in isolation from the community, nor in isolation relative to itself. Your educational programs can't be separate from your tours, which can't be separate from the methodology of your preservation. If you think about all those videos that I threw at you at the beginning of this talk, you can start to see these kind of foundational pieces growing into a new direction, if we pay attention to it, a new direction for preservation, a new direction for interpretation. And so I took 8 minutes extra, so I apologize. Thank you all so much for inviting me to come and speak. Thank you.